I pray to God that you realize the entourage is dead. I pray to God that you not lacking when you off the med. I pray to God she know them Cabo trips don't last forever. Bitch, you argue with her mama, go and get them kids. I pray to God you actually pray when somebody dies. Thoughts and prayers, way better off timelines. False claiming, not cute, I'm mortified. The new earth in high pursuit, 200 lives. Rich nigga, broke phone. Tryna keep the balance, I'm staying strong. Stop playing with me before I turn you to a song. Stop playing with me before I turn you to a song.
1-on-1, never lost. Went to the finals, never lost.
You never got there, Lamar.
Who?
You.
I've been a 1-on-1 champion. Never lost 1-on-1.
Alright, let's get into it.
Back at it again, Cigar Spence. You know what time it is. It's time for, I don't even know what the name of this is anymore. Spencer Co. Podcast is the show. It's not the Coach and Juice, because the coach is here, but no juice. But I got a very, very special guest in the building today, inside of the Six, inside of, well, not Club Shed. I don't want to put rap in Club Shed. Clean Living Man, we're not going to put him out there in those type of environments like that. But one of the best players from Lufkin in the 2000s decade. And this is where we actually ran into each other, making those kind of lists and things like that. But a coach, an outstanding coach on both offense and defense. He's been coaching for a while, made a bunch of stops, Commerce, been in DeSoto's, been in Marshall. Probably another stop that I don't know about. Went to the oil field for a second, got his bread up, all that stuff, man. But a very, very talented, a very, very intelligent, very outspoken, well-spoken man, one that I respect. Mr. Rafael Thomas is in the building, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give it up for Ralph one time. Ralph, how you doing, man?
Good, man. Good.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. If you guys are familiar with Ralph Thomas and the name, I know Ricardo is over here taking pics over here to the side. We've actually argued, me and Ricardo, who was the better receiver from that 06 team. Was it Ralph or was it Dez? I said Dez, and then, of course, Ricardo said Ralph. Ricardo, you here, man. Go ahead and talk to these people one time about what you think.
Trust me, I played in that game. It was Ralph Thomas. We got on that bus, that long ride home from Lufkin to Longview.
Who was y'all talking
about? We wasn't talking about Dez Bryant.
Who was y'all talking about?
The only thing we talked about Dez Bryant was it was a skinny kid on our team, right? He was number 23, safety.
Yeah.
His name was John Ritt.
Yeah.
Big hit of the game. On who? Dez Bryant.
On Dez Bryant.
Not on Ralph Thomas. Ralph Thomas finished the game with 4 touchdowns.
Yeah.
Sent us home sad.
Couldn't catch that, man. Not at all. For one, this game has been a group chat freaking phenomenon for years now. But talk to me about the game in 06 where you went off for 4 touchdowns against Longview at home senior year. Talk to me all about that, Ralph.
What's crazy about that game, man, is I had just got back from Atlanta, Georgia about 3 days before that game, playing with the junior national team, baseball.
Right.
Okay. Well, Team USA, the junior team. I'll never forget it. My brother texted me before the game.
Yeah.
Was like, I need 4 of them tonight.
Yeah.
I said, I got you.
Yeah.
I got you. I talked to my boy Germ, and it just worked out that way.
Right.
I didn't say throw me the ball more or whatever, whatnot.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But obviously, Dez is Dez.
Right.
Everybody know that, man. Hall of Famer, Pro Bowler, you name it, he's done it. That's the guy that got all the hype that game, and obviously, I don't think I was the guy that everybody was game planning for.
Right, right.
But it just worked out that way.
I understand totally, completely. You talk about being an All-American in high school as a baseball player, outstanding slot receiver, outstanding cornerback as well. What was your favorite sport coming up, man?
Baseball. I didn't even play football. I played football 1 year in Little League. And I'm not going to lie to you, I wasn't a fan of the contact and all that stuff. I wasn't soft, but it was one of them deals where it was like, I know I'm real good at baseball.
So I
wasn't real sure about football. And as far as the big deal with me with baseball, it turned into a deal where it taught me life lessons along the way.
Yeah.
That was,
you good. Keep on.
That was
good.
My big deal with baseball. That's why I ultimately liked it, because I had early success in it. Most kids love stuff that they're good at.
Right. So you sent out a tweet, I think, that sparked this whole conversation. I saw it yesterday. You were just talking about the difference in children and the raising that goes on today and then what's going on back then. How would you attribute the way that you were raised by your mother? How did that help you develop as a ball player in both sports or just as a young man in general?
Man, my mom was a dog. That's what she was.
Yeah.
In a good way.
Yeah.
She taught me work. is what she taught. My mom worked 2-3 jobs at a time.
Damn.
And instilled that in me. I've known my mom to go get dropped off at a job and walk to the third job.
Damn.
So these are the type of things I saw growing up.
Right.
So I had no choice but to grow up early and understand that the only way you're going to get something is work. And my big deal with my mom, I never heard my mom come in and complain one day.
Wow.
Not once. So that kind of rubbed off on me.
Nah, that's a dog for sure. For sure. In the best way possible.
For sure.
That is a dog for sure. And now to work that many jobs, never complain, still put on. You had how many siblings you got?
I have 4 brothers and 3 sisters.
4 brothers, 3 sisters. So for her to hold it down for all of y'all at one time, and that's incredible. So shout out to moms.
I
was 7-1 in the same house, correct. But I get exactly what you get where we're coming from on that. So fantastic player. Speed obviously is your best and strongest trait from where I'm sitting at. Matter of fact, you had a baseball game one day. And then you had a state track meet the same day. You played baseball that morning and went and ran that afternoon.
That evening, yeah.
And what place you get?
I got fourth.
Fourth in 100 and 5A when there was no 6A. So this is big boy. This is the best in the state running at one time. And he played a baseball game, traveled in a car the day of the track meet and still finished fourth. Speed obviously is your deal. How would things change if Ralph was 17 in 2022?
It would be totally different.
It's crazy, isn't it?
Because now these kids kind of can market themselves.
Right.
And with a click of a button, they can send out and promote themselves.
Absolutely.
My big deal with that, and people say what they want to say, but if I grew up in these times, I'd be in the top. For sure, top 300.
Easily. ESPN. Easily. And that's, and you know, for me, like, that's where it all started. Because I'm looking up Lufkin players, and I knew your name. Because I went to that 06 game. Mm-hmm. And I remember Ralph Thomas. I'm like, all right, cool. But when you go and you look at these statistics, you're nowhere to be found in the Lufkin statistics. And we don't have to talk about why. Because I don't want to lead it to that kind of a conversation.
That's best.
But you can see where if somebody doesn't know and wasn't there, like, they don't have a clue who Ralph Thomas was. So the changing of with the availability of Twitter and Huddle Highlights and people making top 100 lists and that kind of stuff.
For sure.
I plugged myself there. But definitely the game would have definitely, I think you would have been 4 or 5 star easily because you're a 3-year letterman, 3-year starter at that. You started both ways. How many years you start both ways?
3
years. So you started corner at both corner and receiver for 3 years in a row at a 5A school. And this is easily the most talented school in Longview. The most talented school in East Texas during the 2000s decade. For without sure. question. I think I had you at, 13th? What did I put you at on that list? I know you remember.
It was 11.
It was 11. So I had you right outside of the top 10.
That was based on not having anything to go on.
Exactly. All I had was
said, word of mouth.
Word of mouth, and then your sophomore highlight tape and your senior highlight tape that's on YouTube. So that's about it. So where would you end? And I know you're a humble man, so we all know that. So you go and tell the truth. Where do you think you would have placed in, if we were talking top Panthers from 2000 on, where do you think you'd sit on that list?
I'm for sure in the top 10.
Okay.
No doubt in my mind. Top 10. And you go ask anybody from Lufkin.
Yeah.
And you know how I am. I'm not finna sit here and toot my own horn.
Nah, I know it.
Top 10 for dang sure. And, I mean, we can talk about, you know, Javorski, Reggie, obviously Dez.
Yeah.
You got Quinn Holman.
Yeah.
That's 4.
And then it's Harry after that.
Now we start getting territory.
Ralph can be called anywhere between 5 and 10 in that sense. Okay, and I respect that. I feel that for sure. What do you think the biggest difference is in football now here in 2022 than versus when you played in 04? Because y'all were spread back then.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no way football is the exact same. Mm-hmm. Like, there's no way y'all would run the same spread concepts. I'm not even going to say that. I had a joke, but I'm going to leave it because we don't like it. We're not texting.
Hey, man, this is your show.
I know it.
Say what you got to say.
No, not quite. I'm not going to be that guy today. But what do you think the biggest difference is in between football? Just football in itself. And then, of course, I got to ask you about Lufkin because it's not great over there right now. But we'll just one question at a time. What's the biggest difference between football in the mid-2000s and then versus what it is right now?
Personally, I think toughness and competition.
Right.
Just being real. Kids nowadays, more so, they don't like competing. They want to be each other's friend most of the time.
Yeah.
That's my big deal.
Yeah.
Especially as a coach.
Right.
Drives me crazy.
Yeah.
You know, just like, think about practice. You got this guy over here. That's your buddy.
Yeah.
Well, you're not going to go hard against him because that's your buddy.
Right.
And then you get to games. All these kids know each other now.
Yeah.
They go to camps together. They go to visits together. And so forth and so on. They all know each other on social media.
Right.
So it's one of them deals where when I was growing up, I didn't know who was on South Lake Carroll.
Yeah.
Until we played them.
Right.
Or to the week we played them.
Right.
So I didn't care they had seven guys going D1.
Yeah.
Nowadays you hear guys.
Yeah, nowadays you got the coach tweeting players.
Correct. So nowadays kids are defeated before they even play the game based off of what they see. And what they've heard.
I got to ask you about that. And if you want to share, you want to share. But how do you feel about Coach Todd and him tweeting these players out? And he's building hype around, obviously, the Sox and DeSoto is going to play each other. Mm-hmm. But he's been building a lot of hype around that game. Tweeting, what's the receiver's name? Jonte. He's been tweeting him. And they've been going back and forth.
It's that's Matthew's guy, right? Matthew's guy is Javonte, right?
Yeah, the receiver, yeah.
Okay.
And so these two have been going back and forth. I think it's been fun, but it hovers around that line between adult and kid.
Going too far.
Okay, that's what I'm getting at.
I know what you're trying to say. Go ahead and say it.
It's a little bit too much for you to be talking to a kid, tweeting this kid out, a 17-year-old. Is there a place for it?
I think that depends on the relationship because I don't know the background of the story
as far as the relationship
between Todd and that receiver.
Right.
Because they could know each other.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Right.
Now, obviously, that's a different thing.
Right.
But if they don't know each other, that's too far.
It's a little weird.
Personally, it's a little weird. As an adult, that's too far.
If this was, you know, a cornerback from Sock, then I'd be all for it. That's the kind of entertainment I want. I'll give me a popcorn. I have been a little apprehensive about it. Reading the tweets, I'm like, yeah, I like it because, yeah, that's us. That's ignorant. I love it. Like, and don't get me wrong. Like, this part of my coaching is ignorant. Like, this is kind of who I am sometimes. Right. But it's also like, all right, dog, this is kind of in front of the world. What are we doing?
Pull it back in. I do think they are trying to be a hype for that game.
Oh, absolutely.
Too, personally.
Yeah.
I don't think Coach Ty is a bad dude.
Nah.
I don't. I don't personally know him.
Right.
But I don't think he's silly enough to do that with kids.
Right.
I think it's a relationship there.
Gotta be somewhere between the two. Gotta be a connection for it. Because it is a little. All right, Coach, what are we doing here? What are we doing?
I enjoy it, though. I will. I'm not going to lie to you.
Yeah. Though. No, it's fun. It's a fun read.
They're going at each other.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
That's where I just spoke on.
You know,
guys
that's competitive.
Are scared to do that now.
Absolutely.
They calling each other out, and now they're going to have to back it up.
No doubt.
Like week three?
Yeah.
All the talking over with.
Yeah, absolutely. Change. We didn't have a game that week. I definitely want to pull up and see it in live action because it's going to be crazy. Speaking of Coach Todd, Sock. This is a conversation that we have had separately outside of in the group chats about black staffs and whether or not they can get it done. Sock, I was the one, I ain't got no problem hiding from it. I was the one that said it probably couldn't get done.
Right.
As black people, we can't get along. We don't know how to work to each other, blah, 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 blah. I was the guy that was saying it. I don't think it can get done. Mainly because I kept watching Duncanville keep getting beat to the same team every year, and I'm like, this shouldn't be happening. Mm-hmm. Duncanville shouldn't be looking like this in a state championship game with all those monsters that they have. And so, anyway, I want to say publicly, since, you know, I've said that already, that congratulations to Coach Todd Sock. I was in the building when they won the state championship game. It was a dominant affair. It was organized. It was meticulous. You could tell that they had a game plan. They were going to operate the game plan from an organizational standpoint, which is one of the things that we get discredited from. And sometimes it looks like we ain't organized. And I'll just be honest, when you see some blackleg teams, it look like it's a bunch of ignorant shit going on sometimes. So I have wanted to commend them up in Forest, because when I watched the game, it wasn't that. It was, you know, it was 11 guys on the field trying to win a football game. And it was incredible to watch the whole city of Dallas get behind Sock. And it was a proud moment for me as a black man to watch another black man go out there and win the thing. And I was actually pretty happy to be made a fool of, or not made a fool of, but just be proven wrong.
With that staff.
Absolutely. With that all-black staff, with them doing it the way that they did it.
Yeah.
Shout-outs to Coach Todd. I know we talked about him on Twitter, but nah, shout-out to Coach Todd. He's incredible. And this was an incredible feat, winning the state championship. Now, you have been in a lot of different, not a lot of different, but you've been in different places. You've worked for different coaches. obviously, I want to talk about the legend Mathis. Mm-hmm. How was it working for Coach Mathis? Claude, right?
Right.
Yeah, Claude Mathis, he incredible career at DeSoto, left and went to Texas for a little bit, came back back to DeSoto. So how was it working for Claude Mathis in that time you got a chance to work for him? You worked at him in Marshall, right? Mm-hmm. So he came back from Texas, went to Marshall, then went back to DeSoto, right?
Correct.
So you worked with him at DeSoto and Marshall?
No, I worked with him at Marshall.
At Marshall. So how was it working for Coach Mathis?
Good segue into what we're talking about here, because Mathis is probably one of the most detailed guys that I've been around.
Yeah.
Attention to detail guy.
Yeah.
Borderline OCD.
Yeah.
Perfectionist.
Yeah.
He's a dude that ultimately cares about those kids, but more so he tries to grow you as a coach.
Okay.
He's going to make you uncomfortable, though.
Yeah.
It's not for everybody.
Right.
If you're not trying, off-air conversation we've had, you're trying to grow as a coach.
Right.
And you see yourself down the road being something else.
Right.
Leading something.
Right.
Mathis is the dude who's going to, if you tell him that, he's going to make you uncomfortable and put you in those situations to learn from things and to grow you.
That's incredible.
He is that type. That's what he does best.
That's incredible.
And he's good at just gauging the room and setting the tone of the room.
Right.
Mathis comes in and takes over a room just with his personality and just blending and knowing what to say, and you just watch that and you pull from that.
Absolutely. Your title has grown as years have accumulated. You were the DC this year at Marshall.
I was the
special teams coordinator this year at
and
Marshall.
Co-DC.
Yeah. Y'all had an incredible defense. Y'all stoned us, left us to just 14 points this year in this past season's game. Incredible players all over the field. Montana Warren, I just made a top 100 safeties list, and he made about 5 or 6 plays on that list.
Who's leaving?
It was leaving?
Henderson.
Oh, man.
Yes.
That is.
He moved to Henderson.
And that is a big pickup for Robinson out there, because Henderson's got it going on. That's
news to you.
Yeah, no doubt. That is that's huge. That's definitely huge. That's going to affect some things in my list and whatever. But, okay, it's cool. You've seen yourself grow. How have you grown over the past few years, gaining titles and gaining responsibilities and things? How has that made you a better coach, and what do you think you've changed? If you could pinpoint it to a couple of things, what do you think has changed the most about you?
Getting out of my comfort level as far as taking on those roles.
Yeah.
I always used to sit back and just kind of, you know, talking from the sideline, like, I can do that, I can do this.
Right.
But then you get that opportunity and it's just like, oh, you know how them guys are.
Yeah.
They don't want to do it.
Right.
So finally, I just had to get out of my comfort zone and be like, okay, well, it's my time. I got to quit running from it, per se.
Right.
And just dive in and do it.
Yeah.
But me, it is my big deal as a coach is I'm a believer in tough love.
Yeah.
So finding that balance, though, of tough love and crossing the line.
Which is incredibly difficult nowadays because there is, if you're the only one giving tough love in a kid's life, they don't see it as tough love. They see it as hate. They say, you hating on me, you picking on me, you don't want to see me be great, you thinking I'm blah, 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 blah. And it becomes a clash. And this is kind of where my black man statement comes from. Because I see it happen with me, and I see it happen with some others where you argue with me. Somebody else tell you something, you ain't got a word to say.
Yes, sir.
It's yes, sir, right out the gate. I'm like, hold on. Now, I'm the one that's going to pick you up. I'm the one that's going to buy you something to eat on the way home. I'm the one that's going to do this, yada, yada, yada. But it's an argument. It's a conversation with me. But somebody else tell you that's of a different skin complexion.
Right.
Right? And now it's all of a sudden, it's yes, sir, you automatically do it. which was created, that kind of deal in my head. It's like, damn, we just don't respect each other.
Right.
But it's incredibly difficult to tie that line and walk that line of tough love and I still care about you versus me going across the line, because some kids will take you to limits.
Correct. And as far as especially me getting a special teams coordinator title, a lot of people don't realize you work with everybody.
Right.
So you learn in multiple personalities and different, and you know, certain position groups act differently than others.
Oh, definitely.
And you're working with everybody from O-line to D-line to quarterbacks to receivers to DBs.
Yeah.
I mean, linebackers, you name it, running backs, everybody. It's only two people on the staff that work with everybody.
The head coach
and the special teams coordinator.
No doubt.
That's what people don't understand. And that was my big deal.
Yeah.
It, getting out of my comfort zone and taking that title.
Right.
That took my confidence from, I'm already a confident guy.
Right.
Once I did that, it was just like,
oh, ain't nothing I can't do.
I can do it all.
Yeah.
Personally.
Yeah.
I can do it all because you have so many roles within a special teams coordinator, even more so personally than OC and DC.
Yeah.
People don't know that.
It's as important. It's to me, it's a 33% deal.
Correct.
And it's, you know,
but 33 it's cast offense. It off as like
it's definitely cast it off as just don't miss the extra point and don't kick the ball out.
No, so give it's, a touchdown. It's way more to it.
Absolutely.
Way more.
We talked about special teams. You guys had a special kicker this year, Buck Buchanan. Not too many guys play kicker and then turn around and be your starting free or strong safety. How was that? Because, I mean, he hit the shit out of Jordan on well, it was a reverse, I believe.
Yes.
Jordan came around to try to lead block on Buchanan, and it did not end well for Jordan, per se. But, I mean, that's just a – you mentioned special teams. How was it coaching a guy that's as uniquely talented as Buck was this year for you?
Easy. Buck makes my job easy.
Yeah.
Well, I know I got a guy who's going to boot it out the back of the end zone.
Right.
And can hit 50-yard field goals.
Absolutely.
I don't have anything to do.
Yeah.
As far as teaching him.
Right.
But for Buck's job, Buck's a leader.
Yeah.
People follow Buck.
Yeah.
And Buck is a selfless individual as far as he didn't have to go out there and play safety. Buck's a Division I kicker.
Yeah.
He didn't have definitely, because he's one injury away.
Yeah, from what are we doing?
Messing
yeah.
up his entire career.
No, for real.
But that's the type of kid Buck is. That's how his parents are raised, which great people.
Right.
The Buchanans. But Buck makes my job simple.
No doubt.
And I can't sit here and tell you I did this and that. No, Buck did that.
Yeah. You've coached some receivers who are very talented in your time. A couple who might have a chance to touch the league here. If you had to name, you know I'm a list guy. If you had to name your top five receivers that you've coached, who would you say?
I can give you five without particular order.
Okay.
I can say you got Malik Jackson.
Right.
Daylon Phillips.
Right.
Who both graduated college.
Right. Absolutely.
You got Savion Williams. You got Taj Washington.
Yeah.
You got Jalen Polk, who's at Washington right now. Taj is at USC.
Yeah.
And Savion is at TCU right now.
Right.
And Daylon graduated from Tulsa. Malik is at
ULM.
ULM.
Yeah. Five very good receivers, all within the last decade.
Yes.
All very good players. Ralph Thomas or any of those guys? Can any of those guys touch Ralph Thomas?
Negative.
Yes, sir. I knew I was going to get that answer out of you. Let's see. What else we got over here, man? I don't know how much. Shit, that's all the little questions I had. We done rolled through that. All right, so give me so let's talk Marshall. Y'all built Greedo. He's moved on. Y'all got Coach Alvarez now. Greedo, who has left a legacy.
Mm-hmm.
In itself, from the new field house, from the new outdoor facility, which I appreciated during soccer season because it was cold and raining that one game. We came out there, we got inside the indoor, and I loved it every second. Well, not indoor, but you know what I mean. Under the roof, that was incredible. What's the legacy of Greedo leaving this place? He's obviously – no, he doesn't. He didn't have a win over Longview. That was old boy in 15. That was Harper in 15.
Last win
over Longview. First win since like 99. So just make sure we get that established dominance out there. But what do you think Grill's impact would be at Marshall? Would it be the athletics? Would it be the facilities he built? Or what do you think?
I think Jake, he always describes himself as an athletic director first.
Right.
And he fulfilled that role at Marshall.
Yeah.
He did a great job, especially with female athletics that get – neglected a lot.
Yeah.
He did a lot for the female athletics at Marshall High School amongst facility changes, the Under Armour contract,
right.
the big pavilion to things we do with recruiting.
Yeah.
Jake did all that.
Yeah.
And it's one of those deals that people on the outside don't see.
Right.
They see wins and losses.
Yeah, absolutely.
But inside the building, Jake had his hand in everything as far as turning everything around the athletic department. not just football.
It's already open.
So
go ahead and twist it.
I personally think that's his legacy.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, he came out his first year and won a district title.
Absolutely.
And people forget that.
Yeah.
People forget that. But you know how it goes. Oh, that was Mathis' team.
Yeah.
That's what they'll say.
Right.
But
still got to get it done.
Right.
Still got to get it done.
Man, and one thing about Marshall is a lot of people, they think it's still 1990.
Yeah.
Or 2003, 2004.
Right.
State title.
Yeah,
runs.
Jackie Robinson ain't running around.
They still think that's what the type of athletes you have. We have athletes in Marshall. We do. A lot. But the expectation is state or bust every year.
Yeah.
Which is great. It's cool to win.
But that's unrealistic based off of what you've put out on the field. It's unrealistic to say state championship or bust for Marshall. That's dead on spot. You can't say that after watching those sides play.
Calling it what it is.
Yeah, no, you can't say that. That's a little unfair. We've got that here in Longview. Every year should be a state championship here in Longview. I don't think people really truly understand the level of talent. Like, you know, 05, our team is 05. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's the team that had 13 Division I athletes and got beat in the first round against South Garland, which is still a sore moment for a lot of people in Longview. But it takes more than just having those players. We haven't had a team that's that talented since.
Right.
Even the 2018 team wasn't as talented as the 2005 team. Now, you, of course, coach your son and raised different and all that other stuff, but it's insane for a community to think that you should win a state title every single year, especially in these type of areas. What's the disadvantage of being in East Texas, which I don't think a lot of people really understand? What's the disadvantage from being in East Texas and not named Carthage or Gilmer and coaching in the city?
I think resources.
Appreciate
that, that's the biggest thing, as far as we don't have all those trainers that these kids want to go to down here. And East Texas kids are a different type of kid.
Yeah.
Financially.
Right.
Things are different. Most of these guys, kids are blue-collar kids that come from situations to where their parents aren't wealthy like that.
Yeah.
You got those kids in cities that have trainers from when they are this tall.
Absolutely.
You know? And a lot of kids here don't operate that way.
Right.
It's the school or nothing.
Yeah.
It's school or nothing.
Whatever the school can provide for
anyone. Right.
And another thing that I've noticed is that the amount of transfers is so easy to transfer up there in that city area. You know, we watched Den Ryan, and you're thinking, oh, okay. You know, we played him the first year, and it's like, all right, surely they won't have that many guys on the next year. And then they got the guys that they brought back, and then they got sprinkled in a couple of more. You look at Lancaster, we played them 2 years ago in the playoffs, and then they come back with a different roster the next year that we play them in the roster. And they'll have a different roster when we play them in district this year. I think having to coach what you have,
you got.
And not being able to look across the street and not being able to look down the road and be able to recruit a player, I think that is what makes it so hard to coach here in East Texas, because I don't think people really understand what it's like to go to war with offensive linemen that are 5'10", 230 pounds.
Right.
Playing people that have 6 foot and all these other type of athletes out there. That's the unique thing about East Texas, and you just don't see it at Longview. You see it at Marshall. You see it at Lindale. You see it at all these schools. They have to get in where they fit in at. You got to have an undersized guy playing defensive line. You got to have an undersized guy playing O-line or a slow receiver, but this and that and that. And East Texas is just different because that's all we got. The only people really rich with talent around here is Texarkana. Texarkana might be the most talented city, and they got some of their transfer stuff where people go to Pleasant Grove here and all these other different places. But other than Texarkana, I don't see just this overly rich in talent city. And I think that's why people say East Texas kids are different. You grew up in Lufkin. You played for Lufkin. Obviously, the things haven't been going well in Lufkin the last couple of years. If you could pinpoint it without blaming anybody, what would you pinpoint being the number one reason why Lufkin hasn't had a lot of success since 2017?
That's a good question. And obviously, I'm not going to blame anybody because I think everybody has a hand in it.
Right.
But I would say being stuck in ways can catch up with you.
Okay.
I'll say that.
Okay.
Because being from Lufkin and get my big thing, here's what I say. Being from Lufkin and hearing other people's perspective of Lufkin, I'll tell you what they say.
Yeah.
As far as they said, Lufkin is still stuck in, kind of like I said, the Marshall situation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We're still doing the same things. Everybody's kind of caught up
right
past them.
Right.
Do I think that's 100% true? No.
Right.
And they have kids coming through now where I think that's about to change.
Yeah.
I do.
It's definitely
because that freshman class that they have now and the cash behind that, I think this is where – and that's another thing with East Texas. You got what you got.
Absolutely.
And everybody thinks that, oh, well, that's Lufkin.
Yeah.
Why are they struggling?
Yeah.
Well,
you got what you got.
You got what you got.
Absolutely.
And you have to coach with that.
Right.
And then, you know, East Texas, especially a traditional school like Carthage, Lufkin, Longview, Gilmer. You have a bad year, it's not ever going to be kids.
Nah.
And as coaches, we are never blame the kids.
Right.
But the talent pools are down and they're up in East Texas.
Absolutely.
You can't get fast instantly like you said in the city.
Yeah.
You can't.
You can't just go get so-and-so from somewhere. Yeah.
So you got what you got, and you have to grow that talent, and it's real important, especially in East Texas.
Absolutely.
Your junior high levels, when you start struggling,
that's where it starts from.
You better get down there and start figuring out what's going on.
No doubt.
And I think that was addressed in Lufkin.
I'm glad you brought that up, and I didn't mean to cut you off, but I'm glad you brought that up about the junior high levels. I know people do not understand the importance of junior high football and what it establishes for the high school. I think a lot of people, especially in Longview, think that they can just play their kid wherever, and then when we get to high school, if he want to go to Longview, we can go to Longview, and everything will be all right. This thing has started in the seventh grade.
Yes.
It starts really in the sixth grade in pre-athletics, but it really starts as soon as those kids get middle school, because we have to teach a system. We have to get, you know, have to figure out things and make people want to play for the Lobos. Mm-hmm. Because in this city, you got options. You can go to Spring Hill. You can go to Pontry. You can go to Hallsville. You can go other places. You can go to Tatum, which is I got a question about that later. But you got all these different places, probably, which is problematic in this city, but in a one-horse town like Lufkin, you know, it's essential that you get in there in the middle schools, because if you lose a couple of years there, you could be looking at 5-7.
And there's nothing around Lufkin. That's what people don't understand. Lufkin's the only 5A school within 60 miles of Lufkin.
Right.
It's not – that's the biggest school in that area.
Yeah.
All the other schools are 3A and below in that area.
Right.
A lot of those kids are transferring from Lufkin to those schools so they can play.
Yeah.
So the big deal there is, like you say, is you got what you got.
Right.
And I think that's been addressed. And I know that for sure, because I talk to Coach Quick quite often.
Yeah.
And I think Coach Quick's doing a good job.
Yeah.
With what he has.
With what he has, yeah.
And he'll tell you. Coach Quick ain't going to deflect blame. He'll tell you. And he's said it. Like, I'm not going out like that.
Yeah.
He tell you, I'm not going out like that. We're gonna get this fixed.
That makes me proud as a fan of the rivalry. And I've always been like a closet fan of Lufkin. Like, I always thought the jerseys looked better. I always liked the purple. We always got our ass beat to them when I was growing up. I watched like 13 in a row. So I was like, yeah, well, however many that number is. I watched so many of them in a row. I've always been like, yeah, Lufkin got them dudes over there. So it's kind of disappointing whenever, you know, you line up against a Lufkin and it's like, this ain't the Panthers I know.
Right.
So it's encouraging to hear them, and us being in the same district again, Longview Lufkin. I mean, I love it. I want to win every game by 100 points if we can.
Mm-hmm.
But except when we play Lufkin, I want it to be close.
Right.
I want it to be a fight. I want to have those feelings. I want to feel like I'm in Nacogdoches again, which we might as well talk about it. The game in NAC in 2004, of course, your sophomore year.
Yes.
Most people in those stands ever.
Ever.
Ever. Crazy battle. Y'all won by 10, I think.
Yes.
Of course, that's the game Chris Ivory fumbles a million times.
Four.
And we lost almost all of them. And Vondrell, Vondrell had a crazy game. I think he went 18 for like 180 for a couple of touchdowns.
He had a crazy first half.
Yeah. And then we started dropping the ball on the ground. As you can hear, the competitive comeback guy as he corrects me. Talk to me about that game. It was it's crazy, man. It's in the mindset. It's tattooed in the mindset of all that were there. What was your experience like just being a part of the game, making plays, and just being on the field and being a part of it?
Honestly, man, that's a that's Texas football.
Yeah.
Especially those two programs.
Absolutely.
You catch those two programs third, fourth round of the playoffs, that's what it's gonna look like.
Yeah.
Both towns are gonna be there. You know, we make a joke where you can go rob anybody in the city.
Yeah, yeah.
During game time.
That's the day.
That's the day. Both cities are going to come out. I think it was, what, 25, 30,000 people?
27, I think, was the number I read, but it's up there.
Man, that's a one-in-a-lifetime experience,
yeah.
Especially for kids that are not going to go off and play.
Right.
That's something that they take with them for the rest of their life. And for me, once I got out of that game, everything became real easy then.
Yeah.
It's like, I can't see anything worse than that.
Yeah.
Nothing. And we came out on top, so it was
right.
One of them days.
You lined up in front of Malcolm Kelly. You lined up in front of the, I don't know where to place Malcolm at on in the lonely receivers list, which is why I'm tempted not to come out with one for a while. But
see, I was receiver then.
Okay.
I was strictly receiver.
Okay.
You asked that question earlier. Yeah. I played 1 year both ways.
Okay.
Play receiver the other two.
Okay.
So, but that's back when y'all had them big corners.
Yeah.
Big long, one of them, TCU, I don't even remember.
Cordell Hunter, yeah, yeah, absolutely, yeah.
So, these cats lining up in front of me. I'm a sophomore. They're seniors.
Yeah.
So, but we had that ultimate weapon in the backfield that equalized everything.
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
Mr.
Equalizer.
The equalizer.
So, we didn't do a lot of passing.
Nah, didn't need to. But Lane, not. That
Lane
was that big moment.
Took over that game. Lane definitely took over that game. We needed every yard, every touchdown.
It's those experiences that make you glad that you played football.
For sure.
I remember playing Allen in 08, 09, 10, all three of those years. I remember the 09 game where we came back on them from down like 17 at half, and everybody was there, and it's on the hill. I remember the chill bumps that you get walking out into those packed venues. I remember the emotions that you have, just proud to be with your city, proud to be with your brothers on that. I don't know how anybody could say don't let your kid play football. That's what I'm getting at.
It's crazy.
And for anybody that's ever played football, not the ones that have been on the team and didn't play, but for the ones that have actually had experience being out there on the field, I don't think anybody would say, hey, I wish I didn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
It's insane to me how the game is changing.
That made me think of something you asked earlier. As far as the difference now and then.
Right.
Now we can really get into talking.
Yeah.
My big deal back then, too, what you saw a lot of, you had a lot more program guys.
Yeah.
You had a lot more program guys.
Yeah.
Guys who would run through a wall for that program, didn't care if they played. They didn't care if they were scout team. They didn't care about any of that.
Right.
And you respected those guys.
Yeah.
Nowadays... You don't have – it's a lot of me guys.
Yeah.
Now, I'll be honest with you, anybody. I was a diva receiver.
Yeah.
We all want the ball.
Right.
So we all have that me about us.
Right.
But when I think back, it was so many dudes on our team.
Selfies.
That were program guys.
Yeah.
That knew they would not get in the game, and they were going to still practice hard. They was going to go hard in the weight room. They weren't going to pout.
It's insane. And as you say that, I don't know if I was built with that. I never played a JV game before, right? Mm-hmm. I skipped that. I went straight to varsity and straight and started. So I don't know what it's like to be somebody's backup.
Right.
All I know is that I was out there and playing. So to go back and to think about the guys that knew they weren't going to play and still busted their ass mm-hmm. every single day, brought it every single day, were the most excited ones running out of the tunnel, excited on the sideline.
Yes.
It was their life. It was everything. You see that now that kid is now in theater arts.
Mm-hmm.
Now that kid is in like baseball and he's all baseball because that's where he has the best
right.
chance to be in
right.
a prospect or whatever the case. How much has, this just leads to another question, how much has the impact of trying to be D1 changed the entire game?
That's
when I was in high school, D1 wasn't even a word, right? Like, we didn't give a fuck about D1.
Right.
I didn't. I mean, I did because I knew I've always been smart and I've always been like one of those ones that keeps up with things. This journalism stuff started with me when I was like 14, 15,
yeah.
like just watching Rivals and stuff like that. But so I'm probably one of the few that knew how crazy and important and how cool it was to have a Rivals page
mm-hmm.
in 2007, 8, 9, 5, 6, whenever you were playing.
Now it's in your Twitter bio. It's in your Twitter bio. It's in your Twitter name. You D1 Freddy or you D1 this and you D1 that. How much has trying to go D1 or being seen as a D1 prospect, how much has that, for lack of better words, ruined high school football?
It makes it hard for coaches.
Yeah.
Because the expectation level of kid and parent now
yeah.
is substantially greater than when we were coming through.
No doubt.
Because every kid is D1 a bus now.
Yeah.
They don't care about the – you can see how they even present their offers on social media.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
They treat them D1,
way different.
D2, D3, yeah. NAIA, JUCO. The offers all are different in their
Absolutely.
Mind. So you see this kid that thinks he's D1.
Yeah.
And all that's talking to him is Southern Arkansas.
Right.
Well, he has an offer on the table.
Yeah.
But he don't even want to go there.
He don't even want to tweet it out.
He'd rather go
walk on
somewhere and be home a semester out on the street doing something silly.
Right.
Like I tell cats all the time down there, ain't no scholarships in the hood.
Nah.
So what we participating in that for?
Exactly. How's that going to help me?
And I've never seen on a application, does it say
affiliation?
D1?
Yeah.
I've never seen that on the application.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you go D1? They don't say that.
Doesn't.
It says, where did you graduate from? That's what it asks you.
Yeah.
What college did you go to? Do you have a bachelor's, master's, whatever?
The influence of social media has made everyone feel like their voice, this is going to sound a little fucked up, but it's going to make everyone feel like their voice is important.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone feels like, you know, they have something to say, which totally goes against the model of teaching, which goes against all this new age stuff that you hear, because everyone's important, everyone matters, blah, 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 blah,
right,
blah. And,
right.
and all that on a human level is very important, and I'm not shitting on that. But from a football level, you're not all important.
Yeah.
You can't all be important. At the end of the day, the team has to be the most important thing. You
right.
think I wanted to play center? Hell mm-hmm. no, I didn't want to play center. Right. I wanted to be a linebacker. But I knew if I was going to play linebacker, I wasn't going to play till my senior year. And I was going to be on JV a couple years. Mm-hmm. And I was like, F that. I want to play. I want to help the team. So that was my mindset.
And even more so, everybody can't be the quarterback.
Oh, man.
Everybody can't be the quarterback. It's only one quarterback.
Right.
Look at the positions.
Yeah.
It's only one quarterback. But it goes back to...
You know what, though? You say quarterback, and I don't think it's too many kids that really want that smoke anymore.
My point being is, what's the most important position per se?
Yeah. Yeah, it's quarterback.
We spoke on him off air.
Right.
High school football, you don't run triple option, wing T, that type. Quarterback is important.
Absolutely.
Because that's what a lot of schools go to.
Absolutely.
Wing T, slot T, all that.
When you don't have
quarterback.
Right.
And obviously, kids don't see it often, so it looks like a foreign thing to them.
Right,
so
right,
it's
right,
hard
right.
to stop.
Absolutely.
But if you don't have that cat that can spin it back there and run the show, that's my point. Everybody can't be that guy.
Right.
We gotta have some, I don't wanna say the Chiefs and Indians, but
that's what it has to be.
You gotta have some guys that fall in line.
And you know what's crazy is It's nothing but discipline. It's what children long for.
Right.
You know, everybody wants to get their own way, but the first time somebody makes them do something the right way, that kid respects you for it.
Mm-hmm.
He might be mad at you about it
right.
because he didn't get his own way, but at the end of the day, he was going to want to be around you because he knows he's going to develop and be better because of you. I think when you look at the quarterback position, it's just way – It's not too many kids that want to go into a huddle and demand respect.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to tell you, hey, face this way. Face this way. Hey, shut up, man, so I can get this play out.
Which goes back to my point earlier. Everybody wants to be each other's friend nowadays.
Yes.
Nobody wants to take charge.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to fit in and be the cool guy.
Yeah.
And that's one thing that irks me as a coach.
Why are we being cool?
It's guys that don't understand. Like, and you look around because, you know, we sit here and say this generation, my generation did stuff.
Right.
The generation before that was like, look at that generation.
Exactly.
What the hell are they doing?
Exactly.
But you can't just say, well, all kids are that way now because Carthage is not.
They're not.
They're winning.
Right.
Alito's winning.
Right.
Duncanville, North Shore. So
every year.
It's not every kid. So why is it where you're at? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's one of the big deals where I say how I coach.
Right.
That's why I coach tough. Like I said, tough love. But everybody just hear tough.
Right. Nobody hears the...
They don't hear the love part.
Exactly. They just... And that just... I think I said it earlier. It's just if you're the only source of tough love, it's unrecognizable.
Right.
I don't recognize the love in it because you're not giving me what I want.
Right.
You're not telling me what I want to hear. You're not allowing me to do the things that I want to do. So... Yeah, all of that goes into it. What's next for Raph Thomas, man? What you got on? What you got up, coming up there?
I have a few interviews at some places of interest.
Yeah.
That I'm really looking into because obviously at the end of the day, one day I do want to be OC, DC, head coach.
Absolutely.
So it's some things lined up for that. I won't say where.
Right.
But that's kind of where I'm ultimately getting to. Want to get to, because why are we doing it if we don't get to the top?
I'm not over dramatic when I use words. I kind of know what they mean when I say them. But it was at one point in my early career, I got depressed about opportunities, especially mm-hmm. for black men in this area, in East Texas. How do you think of opportunities? I know there's not a lot. You got Ricklin and Tyler. You've got Jefferson's got a head coach. You got Dangerfield's got a head black coach. But there's not too many black faces that get opportunities in this area.
Mm-hmm.
Has that discouraged you in your career? And if it has, how do you get through that?
Personally, it don't discourage me.
Yeah.
Because I think that's playing into what whoever they are
right.
want.
Yeah. Okay.
They want you to
be discouraged and say, "I'll just be a position coach."
Yeah, ain't try. Because, yeah. I mean, look around, bro. Like, let's just call it what it is. They at some point had to be given an opportunity,
right?
They had to.
Yeah.
So you can't keep throwing experience at me because somebody had to give you an opportunity,
right?
Because you look around. I don't care if it's superintendent, principal, whatever.
Yeah.
You were a first year.
Something. Right.
At some point.
Absolutely.
So don't hit me with and try to throw your insecurities off on me and tell me not to even try.
Yeah.
That's crazy. And I don't live by that. That's why I say it don't discourage me.
No, I understand.
Because I personally feel like, hey, I'm going to shoot my shot. Yeah. All they can do is tell me no.
Absolutely.
So why would I be discouraged? Because for damn sure, that if I don't try, I definitely won't
Definitely won't get my opportunity if I don't get off the porch. You are absolutely correct about that. Well, it's been about 47 solid minutes. Great conversation. I knew I picked the right guy. I knew he'd come here and handle himself well. Appreciate you coming through, man. Appreciate you being on time. Some of y'all I'd ask to interview, it'd be like 6:30 for y'all get in. Man came at 5:36. Had me unprepared. But yeah, no doubt. I appreciate you coming through. Heat Celtics game 6 tonight. Who you got?
Celtics.
Got the Celtics. Get it over with. They're going to
get it over
with, huh? Who's going to be Eastern Conference MVP? You got Brown or Tatum?
They're going to give it to Tatum. You know that.
Give it to Tatum?
They're setting up the Tatum versus Curry showdown. You know what's going on.
The light skins will attack.
You know what's going on, man.
Who you got next? If it goes Warriors Celtics, we won't talk again on the mic. Who you got? If it goes Warriors Celtics, who you got?
I got the Celtics.
You got the Celtics?
I got the Celtics.
Boys getting their first ring around here.
I got the Celtics.
Okay, that'll be fun to watch for sure. I'm very interested in seeing the Warriors in the finals. It's kind of hard not to pick them. I think this might be as good as a Warriors team they've ever had.
And the experience, man. It's hard to go against the experience. It is. That's branched off what we just talked about.
Right.
Experience, but they've been there. They've done it.
And to me, this might be wild. This team might be better than the one they had with Durant. And I know you cannot replace the top-end talent of Kevin Durant.
Yeah.
But if you take the A-plus guy away and then you replace him with a B-plus guy like Poole, and then you replace him with some great guys off the bench like Kuminga, who's a rookie this year, and you got all these different guys that just like, damn, well, he wasn't here in 17 and 18. Mm-hmm. He wasn't here in 17. And they just keep getting better. Steph is only, what, 33? Correct. 34. Yeah, Clay's 32, 33. Draymond, whose impact is minimal. I'm not even going to lie. Listen, Draymond Green.
More than minimal, but I get what you're trying to
do. Draymond Green is, if he played for the Orlando Magic, would be out the league. That's why I say what I say.
He's the perfect
piece. He's the perfect piece for that system and that team.
But I don't know. I don't think he'll be out of the league, but
he's not.
He's smart. You can tell that man knows basketball.
He does.
He's
and he smart. Knows his place on the team. Right. He definitely knows his place on the team. I might be, you know, I was saying that
my for thing dramatic with that, bro, I don't think they win titles without Draymond. I don't. I just don't.
It's a hindsight, so nobody can be right in this. It could be replaced, though. I think what Draymond brings can be replaced. I think can it's it? A little. I've always thought the loud guy was just a little bit like
overvalued. Why haven't they? He's been a problem before. He's butted heads with.
They won't.
Why haven't they traded him?
Because they know how. They know what he brings. They and it's for cheap though. Right, you got to so think
can
about
it be replaced. For them, can it be replaced?
I think so. That's just me. I think so. I think they've drafted the players that can replace him in a couple of years. Does that mean he can be replaced right here this year? Probably not. I'll give you that. Right now, he can't be replaced.
And that's for
What they have and what that's on their team.
Right.
But as an individual basketball player, there is nobody that gets more hype about his individual play and what he brings to a team than Draymond Green. And I get it. I understand the importance, and I get this. But you averaging 9-7-2 anywhere else, get your ass on the bench, and you're not making $25 million a year. You're making about $500,000. Udonis Haslam in his prime. Like, come on, man.
But that man is setting the defensive rotations and so forth and so on. As well. It's more to it than I think he's the glue piece. I really genuinely believe that.
I understand, and I get that. But hell, when you got Andrew Wiggins that you're throwing at people, and it's the pieces that he's got. Like, I mean, he's a coach on the floor, but he hits 1-3 a game in the fourth quarter or one floater in the fourth quarter, and then he act like he just made the game seven shot.
Man, you don't play sports.
No, oh, yeah.
You know he's that guy on the team that says that demands everybody's attention when he talks.
Yeah.
You know it.
I just don't know if it needs to come from the guy that ain't putting in. That's me, though. Like, if I'm the guy that's putting in buckets, hey, man, you talk to everybody else. You not finna talk to me a certain way. And I get that. That's part of the team concept. And that's, you know, that's ego. That's the straight pride and that straight ego right there.
But that goes into exactly organization. What we're talking about. Team building.
Team building. Absolutely.
They know their role. Absolutely. That's Draymond's role.
You're right.
Steph and Clay, that's not what they want to do.
Nah.
So that's his role.
Yeah.
That's why I think.
I don't. And the crazy thing, I think his personality is so demanding and that everybody else is so happy go lucky around there that he's like, you know what? All right, Draymond, go ahead and holler. I don't even want to argue with you right now, fam. You've got it. And the only person that really just didn't go for that was KD. Like, you not finna just say whatever you want to say to me whenever you want to say it. And that's where you see those two clash heads. So you're absolutely right. He is a perfect fit for this team. Like I said, if he played for Orlando, I don't know if he in the league. Because he didn't already say to himself, I don't know how to play in games that don't matter. That year that they sucked because everybody was hurt and nobody played, Draymond just kind of sat down. Oh, my hand hurt. I'm not playing.
I got you.
So it's, you know, that's just me being the negative guy.
To each his own, on that.
Nah, no doubt. Been a great conversation. Anything else you want to say before you get out of here, man?
Good, man. I appreciate you.
Hey, I appreciate you, RT. I don't know when this interview will be out, but we'll get it dropped eventually. I'll be sure to let you know I sent it to you first. It's been another Spencer Company. Ralph Thomas in the building one time. Great aspiring head coach on his way. I see it now. When you get there, if you need somebody, holler at me because if I'm still running around here, I'm. That's it. I appreciate it.